The next item on the agenda is an information item on 2015 regulatory oversight report for waste management. Storage and processing in Canada is outlined in CMD 16M50 and 16M50.A. The public was invited to comment in writing. November 14, 2016 was the deadline set for filing by interveners. I understand we have a representative from licensees in attendance available for questioning, and some of them are available through teleconference. So let's check the teleconference. Who is on? Anybody joining us via teleconference?
Paul Grzeszewski from Nuclear Waste Management Organization.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else?
Ken Anderson from Unitech Services Group.
Good morning, Tim Ryder from Energy Solutions Canada.
Thank you.
Hello, David Sharp from Mississauga Metals and Alloys.
Jerry Bowden, Director of Nuclear Facilities with CANDU Energy Incorporated.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. The way we're going to do this is the presentation will be separated into three parts. Part one addresses class one waste management and storage facilities, including OPG's Darlington, Pickering, and Western waste management facilities and written interventions. After a break, we will resume with the two other parts of the report. We will keep you updated to this complicated process here. So I will now turn to CNSC staff for the presentation as outlined CMD 16M50 and 16M50.8. Ms. Tadros, floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. Haiti Tadros, for the record. With me today for this item is Ms. Corrine Glenn, Director of the Waste and Decommissioning Division, and Ms. Shona Thompson and Julie Mecki, project officers working in the same division. We also have colleague licensing and compliance staff, as well as subject matter experts here with us to help answer any questions the Commission may have. We are here to present the Commission member document 16M50A, the regulatory oversight report for Waste Management, Storage and Processing Canada for 2015. This slide summarizes for 2015 the suite of annual regulatory oversight reports presented to the Commission. The next regulatory oversight report for waste management, storage, and processing in Canada is planned for late 2017. This regulatory oversight report is structured into three sections, highlighting Class 1 waste management and storage facilities, waste processing installations, and a general status update on the waste management initiatives currently ongoing. In this report, certain waste facilities installations, such as the waste management facility at the Pointe Lepreau Nuclear Generating Station, are not included. Nevertheless, there are still appropriate reporting mechanisms in place at the CNSC for these sites to be reported on the table shown in this slide. This is the first annual report on waste facilities and installations presented to the Commission, and it covers the 2015 calendar year. The public has been invited to comment on this report. The report includes CNSC's regulatory activities, licensing activities, major developments and significant events, and the safety control area performance rating for each waste facility and installation found in this report. This report focuses on three safety and control areas of radiation protection, conventional health and safety, and environmental protection, which provide the key performance indicators for these facilities. The focus of these three SCAs, we focus on these three SCAs because there was ever an issue that could affect the health and safety of the public or the environment, it would most likely manifest itself in the evaluation of these three SCAs, even if it was not linked directly with one of them. So on this slide, before continuing, I'd like to just draw your attention to a few errors that was noted in the CMD after the submission deadline has passed. So on pages 25, 34, and 42 of staff CMD 16M50, the CMD states that if the action level of 1 millisievert is reached, they trigger OPG staff to establish the cause for reaching the action level. The actual action level is 1 millisievert of above the planned dose per shift, not 1 millisievert. We'll answer any questions you have as we go forward on particular action levels. In Table 2-9, the license limits at Darlington Waste Management Facility in stormwater samples for gross gamma is 0.037 becquerel per liter, and the license limit for tritium is 1.85 kilobecquerel per liter. The CMD erroneously states that the license limits are less than each of these respective values. The actual value is that actual value. In Table 3-11, the correct value for cobalt-60 in 2013 for the liquid effluent monitoring results at CANDU Energy is 0.0314 gigabecquerels, not the 0.0231 gigabecquerels. And finally, in Table 3-3, the performance ratings for Mississauga Metals and Alloys, Inc. in the emergency management and fire protection, waste management, security, safety analysis, and packaging and transport safety and control area are all rated satisfactory, as opposed to the non-applicable as is currently written in the CMD. These changes do not impact CNSC staff's overall conclusions on the performance of these facilities discussed in the report. Any further errors identified before publication will be corrected, and we do apologize for any confusion this has occurred. So on this slide, the CNSC offered participant funding to assist members of the public, Indigenous groups, and other stakeholders in reviewing this report and submitting written comments to the Commission. The CNSC awarded $4,300 to one funding applicant, Northwatch. The CNSC received two interventions, one from the Canadian Nuclear Workers Council and the other from Northwatch. The theme of these interventions include overall support of CNSC activities at the waste management facilities, gaps that were identified in fuel cycle regulatory reporting, and lack of CNSC information on the initiative for the long-term management of nuclear fuel waste. This particular initiative will be discussed later on in our presentation, and we are available to take questions on these questions from the interveners. In 2015, all facilities had a satisfactory or better performance in all applicable safety and control areas. All radiation doses to nuclear energy workers were below the regulatory limit of 50 millisieverts per year. All radiation doses to the public were below the regulatory limit of 1 millisievert per year. And licensees' environmental protection programs were effective at keeping environmental releases ELERA, and there were no lost time injuries that had occurred. So this next section summarizes some general concepts around the CNSC's risk-informed regulatory oversight activities of the nuclear, of this particular nuclear industry. Broadly speaking, CNSC staff perform regulatory oversight activities through licensing, verification, enforcement, and reporting. These activities enable the CNSC to provide assurance to Canadians of the continuing compliance and safety performance of licensees. CNSC staff verify compliance mainly through on-site inspections and desktop review. We also review licensees' operational activities and licensee documentation. In some instances, CNSC staff may conduct independent monitoring and testing. In addition, licensees are required to report to the CNSC routine performance data and unusual occurrences. CNSC staff assess the level of risk associated with each facility across all applicable safety and control areas. The level of risk is reflected in CNSC staff's compliance plan for each facility, which includes the number and scope of inspections at the facility, the number of document reviews, and any independent monitoring and testing activities that need to be conducted. Areas more significant to safety, such as worker radiation dose control and effluent and emission monitoring, are the subject of more frequent and in-depth verification. Compliance plans are continuously reviewed to take into consideration unusual occurrences, licensees' performance, and lessons learned. CNSC staff use the safety and control area framework in evaluating each licensee's safety performance. The framework, as we know, includes 14 safety and control areas, which are further subdivided into specific areas that define key criteria and components. CNSC staff use 4 ratings to assess a licensee's performance, which include fully satisfactory, satisfactory, below expectation, and unacceptable. A licensee's performance is measured by the ability to minimize all risk posed by the licensed activity and to comply with all regulatory requirements. Performance in each safety and control area is continually assessed by CNSC staff using various inputs from regulatory oversight activities. It is important to note that each safety and control area is evaluated individually and that every facility has different inputs into the annual rating for a specific safety and control area. For example, a rating may not have an input from inspections if no inspections were conducted in that particular safety and control area during the year. However, CNSC staff evaluate and rate other information that this licensee provides in their annual compliance reports. The rating for a safety and control area is not usually derived from just one indicator, but rather from several specific areas and metrics that define key components. The SCA rating is assigned by CNSC staff after considering licensee compliance performance throughout the year. Across the fuel cycle facilities, there are facility assessment and compliance teams, FAC teams. These are facility-specific groups of licensing, compliance, and technical staff. The FAC teams use expert opinion to rate an SCA and represent a holistic summary of that specific safety and control area. CNSC staff rate the performance per SCA based on multiple inputs, as mentioned, including defined metrics such as lost time injury or dose to workers, program implementation at the site, events and licensee actions in response to events, occurrences and repeat occurrences of non-compliance, and the evaluation of a licensee's awareness and training around safety culture. As outlined in CNSC staff's report, all waste facilities and installations have satisfactory or fully satisfactory ratings. These next two slides explain these two ratings and provide an example. If a waste facility or installation receives a rating of fully satisfactory, this means compliance within the SCA or specific area exceeds requirements and CNSC's expectations. Overall, compliance is stable or improving, and any problems or issues that arise are promptly addressed. In contrast, a rating of satisfactory means that compliance within the SCA or the specific area meets requirements. Any deviations in overall compliance are minor and pose a low risk to the overall achievement of regulatory objectives. Should a problem arise, appropriate improvements are planned. This particular example, the Darlington Waste Management Facility, obtained a satisfactory rating in the Security SCA. The Pickering and Western Waste Management Facilities both obtained a fully satisfactory rating in the same SCA. All three of these facilities fall under a common corporate security program. A security-related reportable event occurred at the Darlington Waste Management Facility in 2015. OPG's initial response to the event was not adequate. This led to the downgrade from fully satisfactory to satisfactory in the performance rating for this SCA at the Darlington Waste Management Facility. Ultimately, corrective actions put in place by the licensees were satisfactory to the CNSC staff. The next two slides help explain regulatory limits and action levels. Regulatory dose limits are established to limit the dose received to workers and members of the public. Controlled regulatory release limits are established to limit the quantity of nuclear and hazardous substances released into the environment and are based on the regulatory dose limit for the public. Action levels are facility-specific limits and act as an early indication of potential loss of control or part of a licensee's environmental or radiation protection program. Action levels are set by licensees based on operational performance and alert licensee before regulatory limits are reached. An action level exceedance requires the licensee to notify the CNSC, perform an immediate investigation, and carry out subsequent corrective actions and preventative maintenance to restore the effectiveness of the program. This graph represents the relationship between the regulatory limit, licensee's action level, and administrative level. The regulatory limit is a parameter that, if exceeded, warrants enforcement action. It is shown as the red line in the graph, and licensees must, during normal operation, remain at all times remain below the regulatory limit. Action levels and administrative levels are set by licensees. Exceedance of an action level, shown in the yellow line, is a parameter that may indicate a potential problem of part of a licensee's program. It is important to recognize that an exceedance of an action level does not imply a potential risk to the people or the environment, but identifies that the operating parameter may be outside of the norm based on the facility design. The parameter within the range of normal operation is the administrative level. This is shown as the green region on the graph. Exceedance of an administrative level indicates that an operating parameter is at the upper range of normal operations. Such an event triggers an internal review by the licensee. Licensees are responsible for identifying the parameters of their program that represent timely indicators of potential problems. For this reason, action levels are licensee-specific and may change over time depending on operational conditions. In 2015, CNSC staff conducted independent environmental monitoring in the public areas around the Darlington Nuclear Generating Station, the Pickering Nuclear Generating Station, and Bruce Nuclear Generating Station, to confirm that the public and the environment around these sites are safe. These are the host sites for the three Class 1 waste management and storage facilities that you'll hear about. The 2015 Independent Environmental Monitoring Program results indicate that the public and the environment in the vicinity of these facilities are protected and safe, and that there are no adverse environmental and health effects as a result of site operations. These results are consistent with the results submitted by the licensees, demonstrating that the licensee's environmental protection programs protect the health and safety of people and the environment. Independent environmental monitoring program results are provided on the CNSC website. So this slide shows a map indicating where the waste sites, which will be discussed in this report, are located. All sites are in Ontario, with the exception of the University of Alberta, which is in Edmonton, Alberta. I will now pass the presentation over to Ms. Shona Thompson to walk us through the Class 1 waste management facilities.
Good morning. For the record, my name is Shona Thompson, and I'm the project officer responsible for the Darlington and Pickering waste management facilities. I will now present CNSC staff's assessment of the performance of the Class 1 waste management and storage facilities. There are three Class 1 waste management and storage facilities in Canada. All are located within the province of Ontario. Ontario Power Generation, or OPG, is the owner and operator of all three facilities, which include the Darlington Waste Management Facility, the Pickering Waste Management Facility, and the Weston Waste Management Facility. This table presents the licensing and compliance effort from CNSC staff in 2015. In 2015, CNSC staff performed 8 compliance inspections at the OPG waste management facilities. All findings resulting from these inspections were provided to the licensee in detailed inspection reports. All enforcement actions arising from the findings were recorded in the CNSC Regulatory Information Bank to ensure all actions were tracked to completion. In 2015, 489 person days were dedicated to compliance activities. CNSC staff monitored these facilities through inspections and desktop reviews. This enables the CNSC to provide assurance to Canadians of the continuing compliance and safety performance of the licensee. In 2015, 68 person days were dedicated to licensing activities. There were no license amendments for any of these facilities. However, considerable effort was spent on modernizing the license condition handbook for the Darlington Waste Management Facility. For 2015, CNSC staff rated each of the 14 safety and control areas based on the results and observations from inspections and desktop reviews. For 2015, all of the waste management facilities received a satisfactory rating in all safety and control areas except conventional health and safety, operating performance, and safety analysis, where these facilities received a fully satisfactory rating. The Pickering Waste Management Facility and the Western Waste Management Facility also received a fully satisfactory rating for the security, safety, and control area in 2015. Overall, these ratings indicate consistent management of safety systems at these facilities. The table and graph on this slide show the average and maximum effective doses to nuclear energy workers in 2015. The red line on this graph displays the regulatory annual effective dose that a nuclear energy worker can receive. As shown, the average and maximum doses received by an individual worker at each of the facilities was well below the annual dose limit of 50 millisieverts. This table shows the action level for nuclear energy workers at OPG's waste management facilities. For these facilities, an action level is reached when a person receives an external dose in a shift greater than or equal to 1 millisievert above the planned dose. The planned dose is dependent on the worker's job function and duties for the day. For example, a person who welds a dry storage container will have a higher dose assigned to them than an office worker. In 2015, there were no exceedances of the action level or regulatory limit. The table on this slide shows the annual estimated dose to the public for 2015. Doses to the public are attributed to environmental releases. A separate action level applies to different contributing factors. These factors include releases such as airborne and liquid releases. The regulatory annual effective dose limit for a member of the public is 1 millisievert. As shown, the average annual dose received by a member of the public at each of the waste management facilities was well below the annual limit of 1 millisievert. The Environmental Protection SCA encompasses environmental management systems, effluent and emissions control, and assessment and monitoring. As required by their licenses, each waste management facility implemented and maintained an environmental protection program. This may include monitoring airborne releases, liquid effluent, radiation, and/or groundwater, performing weekly samples on collected stormwater runoff, and providing quarterly operational reports to the CNSC on various environmental activities which are reviewed by CNSC staff. Overall, the performance ratings for the Environmental Protection, Safety and Control Area indicate that all waste management facilities have met licensing requirements and are consistent with the performance ratings presented in CNSC staff's previous consolidated interim status reports on OPG's waste management facilities, last presented to the Commission in June of 2015. OPG has established and implemented a corporate-wide environmental management system that applies to all three waste management facilities. OPG's corporate-wide environmental management system is registered under the International Standards Organization 14001 standard. As an outcome of registration, the environmental management system is subject to periodic independent third-party audits and reviews in an effort to verify its sufficiency and also identify potential improvements. Each waste management facility has derived release limits for airborne and liquid releases. The CNSC requires OPG to provide airborne and liquid release monitoring results in quarterly operational reports submitted to CNSC. CNSC staff reviewed the information submitted for 2015 and conclude that OPG's effluent monitoring programs confirm that airborne and waterborne releases of hazardous and radiological substances remained below the applicable regulatory limits. The CNSC also requires OPG to report its radiological monitoring results on a quarterly basis to CNSC staff. Radiological monitoring activities include the placement of environmental dosimeters on perimeter fencing to ensure doses to non-nuclear energy workers do not exceed the dose limits for a member of the public. CNSC staff reviewed OPG's environmental monitoring programs for each of the waste management facilities and conclude that the releases of both radiological and hazardous substances to the environment pose no risk to the public or the environment. There were no exceedances of license limits for any waste management facility in 2015. A lost time injury is an injury that takes place at work and results in the worker being unable to return to work and carry out their duties for a period of time. The number of lost time injuries that occur per year are a key performance measure. As shown in this slide, there were no lost time injuries in 2015 at the OPG waste management facilities. CNSC staff conclude that waste management facilities have been implementing their conventional health and safety programs fully satisfactorily during 2015, and that their programs were effective in protecting the health and safety of persons working in the facilities. The next sections will cover each of the waste management facilities in detail, starting with the Darlington Waste Management Facility. The Darlington Waste Management Facility, or DWMF, is located at the site of the Darlington Nuclear Generating Station, or DNGS, on the north shore of Lake Ontario in the municipality of Clarington, Ontario. The DWMF stores only high-level radioactive waste. Dry storage containers, or DSCs, containing used nuclear fuel from the DNGS are processed and stored here. The DWMF is contained within its own protected area, within the site boundary of the DNGS. The DWMF consists of an amenities building, one DSC processing building, and two DSC storage buildings. The transfer of loaded DSCs from the DNGS to this waste management facility is conducted on OPG property with a security escort. The DWMF has the capacity to store 983 DSCs in both storage buildings combined. The license for the DWMF authorizes the construction of two additional storage buildings, which would allow for an additional storage capacity of 1,000 DSCs. The license for the DWMF also authorizes the construction of one intermediate level waste storage building, the retube waste storage building. In November 2014, CNSC staff received advanced notification of OPG's intent to construct this building. Prior to the commencement of construction activities, OPG was required to submit an environmental management plan, a construction verification plan, and project design requirements. These documents were included in OPG's November 2014 submission. Following a review of OPG's submission in February 2015, CNSC staff, as delegated by the Commission, accepted these documents and construction of the retube waste storage building proceeded. CNSC staff verified that this activity poses no added risk to the public or the environment. The current license is valid until April 2023. The table on this slide shows the license limit, action level, and actual emissions of particulate and air emissions at the DWMF. The DWMF falls under the derived release limits for the DNGS. The license limits are based on the 1 millisievert regulatory dose that a member of the public can receive in a year. The actual emissions from DWMF are significantly lower than the license limit and action level. Next, I will discuss the Pickering Waste Management Facility. The Pickering Waste Management Facility, or PWMF, is located at the site of the Pickering Nuclear Generating Station, or PNGS, on the north shore of Lake Ontario in Pickering, Ontario. The PWMF stores high-level radioactive waste, as well as intermediate-level radioactive waste, from the refurbishment of the Pickering A Nuclear Generating Station in 34 above-ground dry storage modules located at the retube component storage area. The retube component storage area is closed to the receipt of any new intermediate-level waste. DSCs containing used nuclear fuel solely from the PNGS are processed and stored at this facility. The transfer of loaded DSCs from the PNGS to the PWMF is conducted on OPG property with a security escort. The PWMF has the capacity to store 1,154 DSCs in three storage buildings and also has the potential for a further storage capacity of an additional 500 DSCs by the construction of an additional storage building. This construction is authorized by their waste facility operating license for the PWMF. There have been no major changes to this facility or its operation in 2015. The current license is valid until March 2018. OPG has applied for a license renewal and has informed CNSC staff of their plans for additional construction, including a new processing building to replace the current processing building. This construction also encompasses two additional storage buildings. The commission hearing is currently scheduled to take place in April 2017. The table on this slide shows the license limit, action level, and actual emissions of particulate and air emissions at the PWMF. The PWMF falls under the derived release limits for the Pickering B nuclear generating station. The license limits are based on the 1 millisievert regulatory dose that a member of the public can receive in a year. The actual emissions from this facility are significantly lower than the license limit and action level. Next, I will discuss the Weston Waste Management Facility. The Weston Waste Management Facility, or WWMF, is located at the site of the Bruce Nuclear Generating Station, or BNGS, on the east shore of Lake Huron in the municipality of Kincardine, Ontario. The WWMF includes both a low and intermediate level waste storage facility and a used fuel dry storage facility. The low and intermediate level waste storage facility receives low-level radioactive waste from the Darlington, Pickering, and Bruce nuclear generating stations. The waste may be stored as is or processed to reduce its volume through either incineration or compaction. The used fuel dry storage facility is contained within its own protected area, separate from the protected area of the BNGS, but within its site boundary, and consists of one DSC processing building and four DSC storage buildings. The used fuel dry storage facility has the capacity to store 2,000 DSCs. The transfer of loaded DSCs from the BNGS to the WWMF is conducted on the Bruce Power site with a security escort. The license for the WWMF authorizes the construction of an additional 9 storage buildings for low and intermediate level radioactive waste, 128 in-ground storage containers for intermediate level radioactive waste, and 2 DSC storage buildings. There have been no major changes to this facility or its operation in 2015. The current license is valid until May 2017. OPG has applied for a renewal, which includes a proposal for an expansion of the facility. The commission hearing is scheduled to take place in April 2017. The table on this slide shows the license limits, action levels, and actual emissions as measured in various locations at the WWMF. This includes measuring tritium, carbon-14, particulate, and iodine-131 in air emissions, as well as tritium and gross beta in liquid effluent. The WWMF has its own facility-specific derived release limits for airborne and liquid releases. The license limits are based on the 1 millisievert regulatory dose that a member of the public can receive in a year. Liquid effluent discharged from the site include both subsurface drainage and stormwater. Waterborne effluent leaving the facility is collected at various sample stations located on site. Weekly samples are taken from each sample station and analyzed for tritium and gross beta activity. Results of the individual sample stations are combined and reported to the CNSE as a total emission from the facility. Results of the radiological effluent monitoring program are provided to the CNSE in quarterly operational reports. The actual releases from the facility are significantly lower than the license limit and action level for every type of release. There were no exceedances of any of the action levels at this facility in 2015. As part of OPG's environmental monitoring program, liquid releases are monitored at 18 wells, which were consistently below the derived release limits. One well, water sampling hole 231, has indicated elevated tritium concentration since the late 1990s. In 2010, OPG investigated the issue and identified water vapor from the waste in the low-level storage buildings as the cause of the anomaly. After the implementation of corrective measures, results since 2011 have indicated a declining trend at this monitoring well. CNSE staff continue to review the results of this well, in addition to the other monitoring results, to ensure the safety of WWMF's operations. The concentration of tritium levels in water sampling hole 231 peaked in 1990 at 80,000 becquerels per liter. OPG implemented corrective actions, and results since 2011 have indicated a declining trend. In 2011, the tritium level at water sampling hole 231 dropped to 75,000 becquerel per liter. Since then, it has been decreasing, and in 2015, the tritium level was at 25,000 becquerel per liter. Groundwater at this site is not used for human consumption. Therefore, the elevated levels of tritium at WWMF's water sampling hole 231 do not pose an unacceptable risk to humans. Additionally, OPG submitted an environmental risk assessment and predictive effects assessment earlier in 2016 for this facility, taking into consideration all contaminant releases, including tritium from groundwater. CNSC staff have reviewed this assessment and concluded that tritium at water sampling hole 231 and elsewhere around the site are at acceptable levels. To summarize, in 2015, at the Class 1 waste management and storage facilities, all facilities have satisfactory or better performance in all safety and control areas. All radiation doses to nuclear energy workers were below the regulatory limit. All radiation doses to members of the public were below the regulatory limit. The licensee's environmental protection programs were effective at keeping environmental releases ALARA, and no lost time injuries occurred. CNSC staff are satisfied that there are waste management and storage facilities in Canada. This concludes the update on the Class 1 waste management and storage facilities. We will now break in our presentation to address any questions the Commission may have on the Class 1 waste management and storage facilities.
Okay, I think you don't need further introduction. You go into next part. So over to you, Mr. Adwas.
Good morning, my name is Corinne Glenn, and I will present the CNSC staff assessment of the performance of waste processing installations. There are 8 waste processing installations covered by this report. All are located in Ontario, except for the University of Alberta, which is located in Edmonton, Alberta. Due to the nature of their licensed operational activities, Unitech does not have a physical location for storage or processing in Canada. This table presents the licensing and compliance effort from CNSC staff for 2015. CNSC staff performed 9 compliance inspections at the waste processing installations. All the findings resulting from these inspections were provided to the licensees in detailed inspection reports, and all enforcements arising from the inspections were recorded in CNSC Regulatory Information Bank to ensure that all these enforcement actions were tracked to completion. 207 person days were dedicated to compliance activities in 2015 through inspections as well as through the review of licensee reports. CNSC staff monitor waste processing installations to enable the CNSC to provide assurance to Canadians of the continuing compliance and safety performance of the licensees. In 2015, CNSC staff spent 108 person days on licensing activities for waste processing installations. There were no license amendments for any of the installations. However, considerable effort was spent on modernizing the associated license condition handbooks. 2 licenses were revoked in 2015. Given the low-risk nature of these installations, all licenses were issued by a CNSC designated officer. CNSC staff have rated each applicable safety and control area based on the results and observations from inspections and desktop reviews. For 2015, all of the waste processing installations received a satisfactory rating in all of the applicable safety and control areas. Some SCAs do not apply to all installations. For example, Unitech's operation involves a truck that travels from a Canadian licensed facility to the United States. There are no environmental releases resulting from this activity, therefore this SCA does not apply. Overall, these ratings indicate consistent management of safety for all installations. The graph and table on this slide show the average and maximum effective dose to nuclear energy workers in 2015. The red line on this chart displays the regulatory annual effective dose limit that a nuclear energy worker can receive. As shown, the average and maximum dose received by an individual worker at each of these installations was well below the annual dose limit of 50 millisieverts. Please note that there are now energy workers, nuclear energy workers at some of the facilities. This table shows the action levels for nuclear energy workers at waste processing installations. For these installations, there are action levels set at various time frequencies depending on the installation. Additionally, some installations have multiple action levels. For example, the University of Alberta has quarterly action levels, as shown in the table, in addition to annual action levels to ensure the protection of their nuclear energy workers. Some installations are not included on this slide as they do not have nuclear energy workers. In 2015, there were no exceedances of the action level or regulatory limit at any waste processing installation. The table on this slide shows the annual estimated dose to the public for 2015. The regulatory annual effective dose limit that a member of the public can receive is 1 millisievert per year. As shown, the average annual dose received by members of the public at each of the installations covered by this report was well below the annual limit of 1. Doses to the public are attributed to environmental releases. A separate action level applies to different contributing factors. These factors include airborne and liquid releases. As shown on this slide, there were no lost time injuries in 2015 at the waste installations. CNSC staff conclude that waste installation licensees have been implementing their conventional health and safety programs satisfactorily during 2015, and their programs were effective in protecting the health and safety of persons working in their installations. The first installation I will discuss in details is Energy Solutions Canada. Energy Solutions Canada Corporation, or ESC, formerly known as Monserco Limited, is a low-risk licensee that has been in operation since 1978 and manages the handling and processing of low-level radioactive material. Energy Solutions collects low-level radioactive waste from licensed nuclear facilities such as nuclear power plants, hospitals, universities, and research institutes on a contractual basis. Radioactive material is either sorted and or repackaged at its Brampton location or directly shipped to the United States for processing via incineration or recycling. The resulting ash from incineration is returned to Energy Solutions and then routed to a licensed nuclear facility such as Chalk River Laboratory for disposal. There have been no major changes to the installation or its operations in 2015, and its current license is valid until 2022. The next installation I'll discuss is CANDU Energy. CANDU Energy Incorporated was a low-risk installation that refurbished contaminated tools and equipment used to service nuclear generating stations. A CNSC-designated officer issued CANDU Energy a license in September of 2011. During 2015, the licensee informed the CNSC that operations at this location would cease and requested to revoke their license as the lease on their existing building was expiring. CANDU Energy planned to request a new license to conduct the same activities at a different location, at a building owned by CANDU Energy. CANDU Energy ceased operations at this location in July of 2015 and began the process of decommissioning the installation. CANDU Energy provided staffs with a detailed decommissioning plan and an end-state decommissioning report, which described the activities performed to return the building to unrestricted use. CNSC staff reviewed the documents submitted by CANDU Energy and conducted an inspection in November of 2015, which focused on the verification of the decommissioning activities. No issues were identified during this inspection, and CNSC staff confirmed that the decommissioning of the installation had been completed in accordance with CNSC requirements, and the site was released for unrestricted public use. As a result, in December of 2015, a CNSC-designated officer revoked this license. A new license was issued in August of 2016 for CANDU Energy for their new location in Mississauga. This license is valid until 2026. The next installation is the Central Maintenance and Laundry Facility. The Central Maintenance and Laundry Facility is a low-risk installation located at the site of the Bruce Nuclear Generating Station. The Central Maintenance and Laundry Facility is designed, operated, and used to support the operation of Bruce A and B nuclear generating stations. The radiological work programs at this location are conducted under this designated officer-issued license. The work programs include maintenance and calibration of radiation instruments, station equipment maintenance, and processing of active laundry. There have been no major changes to the installation or its operations in 2015, and its current license is valid until August 2017. I will next discuss Unitech Services Canada Limited. This is a low-risk licensee that provides the decontamination services for Canadian licensees. Unitech takes possession of the nuclear substances at a licensee's location after Unitech's trucks have been loaded and locked by the licensees. They then export these items to their facilities in the United States, and once decontaminated, the items are returned to the owners. Due to its license activities, Unitech does not have a physical facility for storage or processing in Canada. Their license is required to possess and export the items they collect. There have been no major changes to this licensee's operations in 2015, and their current license is valid until 2020. The next installation covered in this report is the waste installation at the University of Alberta. The University of Alberta Clover Bar Hazardous Waste Management Facility is a low-risk installation owned and operated by the University of Alberta. This installation manages a variety of radioactive wastes that are solely generated by the university itself. Waste management techniques used here include collection, characterization, volume reduction, and disposal. There have been no major changes to this installation or its operations in 2015. Its current license is valid until March of 2017, and the licensee has applied for a renewal of their license. Another similar installation is the University of Toronto. The University of Toronto Radioactive Waste Management Facility is a low-risk installation owned and operated by the university. This installation manages a variety of chemical and radioactive waste streams that are solely generated by the university facilities itself. The University of Toronto's waste management facility ships compacted drums of lab waste, drums of liquid scintillation vials, and sealed sources to another waste management licensee. There have been no major changes to this installation or operations in 2015, and their license is valid until 2024. The next waste installation is Mississauga Metals and Alloys. Mississauga Metals and Alloys, Inc. is a metal recycling installation. Prior to 2007, Mississauga Metals imported zirconium metals, tubes, and alloys that were slightly contaminated with uranium for decontamination. This led to an unacceptable volume of accumulated radioactive wastes at this facility in both solid and liquid form. Although being safely stored, no systems were in place to reduce the volumes of accumulating wastes. In 2007, a CNSC-designated officer issued a license allowing Mississauga Metals to safely manage the existing waste inventory and reduce this inventory by processing and shipping to an authorized disposal facility. No further decontamination of nuclear contaminated metals was permitted under this license. Under Mississauga Metals' current license, CNSC requires monthly reporting on the reduction of contaminated waste on site and does not authorize Mississauga Metals to accept any new radioactive material. In 2015, the volume of liquid waste on site has decreased from 184,000 liters to 148,000 liters, with a total reduction of 36,000 liters. There have been no major changes to this installation or its operations in 2015, and their license is valid until 2019. Another similar installation to Mississauga Metals is Richmond Metals Recycling. Richmond Metals Recycling, Inc. was a metal recycling company specializing in zirconium tube recycling. CNSC staff issued an order to Richmond Metals Recycling in June 2015 for failing to adequately respond to CNSC's repeated requests for information. The order issued by CNSC staff required Richmond Metals to immediately cease all operations authorized under their license and place all drums containing contaminated zirconium tubes into safe storage until a sufficient number of qualified workers were able to safely carry out the licensed activity. CNSC staff also required the licensee to provide a satisfactory response to CNSC staff's November 2014 inspection and to submit reports periodically as required by their license. In July 2015, Richmond Metals submitted a request to the CNSC to revoke their license. Following this request, Richmond Metals initiated the cleanup of their installation with the assistance of a qualified third party. CNSC staff issued a second order in September 2015 staff discovered a small amount of radioactive contamination in the facility while on inspection. The second order required Richmond Metals to check all items before they were removed from the facility, to submit a facility decommissioning plan to CNSC for approval, and to conduct decommissioning of the installation, and to submit a report on the decommissioning. CNSC staff verified through inspection and direct measurements that the installation was successfully decontaminated. The results demonstrated that there was no risk to the health and safety of the public or the environment and demonstrated compliance with CNSC requirements. In November 2015, a CNSC designated officer revoked the license issued to Richmond Metals, and the site was released for unrestricted public use. The resultant cleanup report is posted on the CNSC website. To summarize this section, in 2015, at waste processing installations, all installations have or had satisfactory performance in all the applicable safety and control areas. All radiation doses to nuclear energy workers were below the regulatory limits, and all radiation doses to the public were well below the regulatory limit. Licensees' environmental protection programs were effective at keeping environmental releases as low as reasonably achievable, and no lost time injuries occurred. CNSC staff are satisfied that waste processing installations in Canada operated safely in 2015. We will now break in our presentation to address any questions the Commission may have on waste processing installations.
Thank you. Should do part three? Okay. Part three it is. Mr. Tadros, it's still you.
Thank you, sir. Heidi Tadros for the record. I'm going to pass this final section to Ms. Julie Mecki, who will walk us through a status update on the waste management initiatives currently ongoing.
Good afternoon. My name is Julie Mecki. I will discuss the status update on waste management initiatives. There are three waste management initiatives that the CNSC will discuss. The first, Ontario Power Generation's Deep Geologic Repository Project. The second, the Nuclear Waste Management Organization's Adaptive Phase Management Initiative, and third, the Joint Convention on the Safety of Spent Fuel Management and on the Safety of Radioactive Waste Management. The first initiative I will speak to is Ontario Power Generation, or OPG's Deep Geologic Repository, or DGR. OPG's DGR is for the long-term management of its low, or LLW, and intermediate level waste, or ILW, waste produced from OPG's owned and operated facilities. The intended purpose of the DGR would be to provide an in-place volume of approximately 200,000 cubic meters of packaged radioactive waste, which would consist of about 90% low-level waste and 10% intermediate-level waste. It is important to note that this facility would not be for the long-term management of used nuclear fuel. The low and intermediate-level waste is currently stored at Western Waste Management Facility. As seen in this drawing, the proposed DGR would be located on the Bruce Nuclear Site, immediately adjacent to the Western Waste Management Facility. The radioactive waste would be in place within rooms excavated in limestone at a depth of approximately 680 meters below ground surface. In 2011, OPG submitted an environmental impact statement and application for a license to prepare site and construct the DGR. The CNSC and the Canadian Minister of Environment then appointed a three-member joint review panel, or JRP, to conduct an examination of potential environmental effects of the project and to consider OPG's application for a CNSC license to prepare site and construct the facility. The panel held public hearings in local communities in 2013 and 2014 for a total of 33 days. The public hearing process provided an opportunity for participants to provide input and ask questions on the project. The proceedings, with over 200 public interventions, were webcast on the CNSC website, and the CNSC delivered a total of 18 presentations. The panel issued its report on May 6, 2015. Overall, the panel concluded that the project is not likely to result in significant adverse environmental effects, taking into account the implementation of the mitigation measures committed by OPG together with the mitigation measures recommended by the panel. And it is not likely to cause significant adverse effects on Aboriginal interests. The report included 97 recommendations and is publicly available. In February of this year, the Minister of Environment and Climate Change requested that OPG conduct additional studies and provide additional information prior to making a decision on the environmental assessment. Specifically, the minister requested additional information on alternative sites for the project, cumulative environmental effects of other projects in the vicinity of the proposed location, and mitigation commitments. In April 2016, OPG responded to the minister's request, indicating that additional information would be submitted by the end of December 2016. On December 12, 2016, the Governor and Council announced its decision to extend the time limit for the issuance of a decision statement on OPG's DGR by 243 days. If an environmental assessment is approved, the panel will then make a licensing decision. No regulatory decisions have been made to date. Now I will discuss the second initiative, which is the NWMO's, or Nuclear Waste Management Organization, Adaptive Phase Management Initiative for a Deep Geological Repository for Canada's Used Nuclear Fuel. CNSC staff provided an update on CNSC's role and outreach activity at the Commission meeting in February 4, 2015. The NWMO was established in 2002 by Canada's nuclear energy corporations, Ontario Power Generation, Hydro-Quebec, and New Brunswick Power Corporation. And they did this in accordance with the Nuclear Fuel Waste Act. Under the Nuclear Fuel Waste Act, the NWMO is responsible for long-term management of Canada's used fuel bundles removed from commercial and research reactors. The selected approach for the long-term management of used nuclear fuel is the adaptive phase management, or APM. No application has been submitted by the NWMO. It is international best practice for the regulator to get involved early in these initiatives that may involve the long-term management of radioactive waste, such as a deep geological repository for used nuclear fuel. CNSC is involved early in the process to ensure that the future license applicant, the NWMO, and potentially affected communities have a comprehensive understanding of the CNSC's role in regulating Canada's nuclear sector, and if a license were submitted to CNSC in the future, the public hearing process. CNSC operates in an open and transparent manner. As such, CNSC staff post information on our early involvement on the CNSC website. The following are examples of activities that CNSC have conducted. We conduct outreach activities to explain our role. We highlight the science that CNSC is conducting internationally on deep geological repositories and how this could be used in future regulatory decision making. We identify regulatory requirements to the future applicant. One way the CNSC has done this is to conduct a pre-licensing review of conceptual design and an illustrative safety assessment associated with two hypothetical but realistic sites, one in a crystalline rock formation and one in a sedimentary rock formation. And also to provide feedback early in the process, CNSC staff have conducted an assessment of the NWMO's management system for contractor procurement process for siting. CNSC involvement will continue to expand as the APM initiative moves forward. Now I will focus on CNSC's pre-licensing outreach activities. At this early stage, before a license application has been submitted, staff outreach activities serve to explain CNSC's regulatory role as the independent watchdog and also to build relationships with these communities. CNSC meets with communities, First Nation, Métis citizens who have expressed interest in learning more about CNSC's regulatory role. The format and sequencing can be as followed: a day-long meeting with CNSC specialists in Ottawa, CNSC presenting at meetings in the community, and also CNSC conducting open houses in the community. All of these activities are performed at the request of communities. This map shows two things. First, the blue circles are the communities who are still in the NWMO's Learn More process. There are currently 9. Second, it also shows CNSC's outreach activities that were conducted in 2015, as shown by the colored squares, purple squares. So the green color triangle represents CNSC staff being invited to the community to present, and the purple colored squares represent where CNSC staff have been requested by the community to conduct a CNSC open house. In addition, in 2015, CNSC staff met with Spanish Neighboring Liaison Committee and the Métis Nation of Ontario in Ottawa. These are CNSC's key messages when we're conducting outreach activities. First, CNSC is the independent regulator, and we conduct our own independent research. Next, there's been no license application, and it is early in the process. CNSC does not promote the APM initiative and nuclear energy, nor does it create energy policy. CNSC's role is to ensure safety. Last, I will discuss the Joint Convention on the Safety of Spent Fuel Management and on the Safety of Radioactive Waste Management, or Joint Convention. Canada was one of the first countries, known as contracting parties, to ratify the Joint Convention, which came into force in June of 2001. The CNSC coordinates and submits the National Report on behalf of Canada. These reports represent a collective work and involve cooperation from various federal departments, as well as input from licensees and industry organizations. Canada's national reports are published together with responses to questions received from other contracting parties. All Canadian national reports can be found on CNSC's website. The fifth review meeting of the Joint Convention was held in May 2015 in Vienna. Canada presented its fifth national report. On August 20, 2015, the CNSC presented an overview of the fifth review meeting at a commission hearing. Regarding the next steps, the sixth national report will be submitted in October of 2017, and the sixth review meeting will take place in May of 2018. Now I will hand the presentation back to Ms. Tadros.
So these are our final sort of concluding slides of the regulatory oversight report that you've had before you today. I'll skip through the next slide because I think you've heard CNSC staff's overall conclusions with regards to licensees programs. You've seen this slide before, and basically welcome any comments or questions you may have on what we've presented today with regards to this third section and how to move forward.
Thank you.